Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, the walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name, yeah. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name, yeah. Woo. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name.
To you this morning, Jesus. I'm giving you my all. I'm giving you my worship. We love you, Jesus. We give you all the praise. We give you all the thanks. We adore you, Jesus. We bow down before you. We worship you. We praise you. Hands lifted high. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Three Rivers Church. Welcome to our online service. Good to see everyone again this week. My name is Steve, if you don't know me, and welcome. And thanks Josh, who's leading us in worship this week. Paul's going to be around a bit later to speak to us this morning as well. And also we got communion today, so if you haven't got bread and wine ready, now's the time to go and grab that for a bit later on. If you're meeting in the building, I hope you're not too cold. We have been told that we've got to still keep the windows and doors open to allow ventilation in the building at this time. So that means as it gets colder, we've still got to keep windows open. So bring extra blankets, bring things you can wrap around you if you're meeting in the building, because it's going to be a bit cold potentially. If you would rather stay in your warmth at home, then of course, feel free to watch online on YouTube instead and join us that way. Tonight, we've got our AGM is happening tonight. That's at 6 o'clock on Zoom is the AGM. And please join us tonight. We've got some news that we want to bring you. So join us for that so that you can hear what's going on in the family of the church tonight at 6 o'clock. And also today, we've got our heap offering. So twice a year, we have an opportunity to give over and above our usual giving. And so we're doing that again this week. So please, if you're able, then think about giving. All the details how you can do that are on the website and in the news sheet as well. All right. Things that are happening this week. Tomorrow, Monday, we've got our usual church weekly prayer meeting on Zoom. That is now going to be happening at 10 o'clock instead of 11 o'clock. So join us on Zoom if you can for that. The details of that and all the other Zoom meetings and everything else that's going on are in the news sheet. There's lots of other things in the news sheet that I can't mention because of time. Please take a read at that so that you know what is going on. Hope 2020 prayer is this week, once a month, the 20th of the month at 8:20, 2020 for 20 minutes. Pray for the nation. Just wherever you are, just take some time just to think and just to pray for the nation at this time. All right. So 2020 prayer is Tuesday this week. Okay, I'm going to read some scripture, so let's stand together if you're able. We're going to read some scripture together and let's continue in the presence of God. I want to read from Colossians chapter 3. It says this: Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above where Christ is. Because Christ has come, he has raised us to be with him. He is at the right hand of God, it says, and he's raised us up to be with him. We are with him in spirit. We are with him because he has been raised. We have been raised with him as well. And it says, set your mind on heavenly things rather than earthly things. Don't be worrying and setting your mind on what's happening here on earth. Set your mind on him. Free yourself by setting your mind on Christ who's above. Yeah. It says, you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Yeah, when we die to sin, we are hidden with him and we are with Christ in God. So set your mind on him. Set your mind on heavenly things rather than earthly things. So wherever you're at this morning, let's forget about the earthly things. Let's forget about those things that are going on in our life. Let's leave them behind and let's set our mind on him. Let's set our mind on earthly things this morning. So, Father, we thank you that Jesus has come. We thank you that we've been set free from sin. We've been set free from earthly things that bind us and bond us and break us down, Father. Instead, let us be free, Lord. Thank you that you have set us free from those things. And, Father, we ask you to help us to not to set our minds on those things, Lord, but to set our minds on you instead. We ask you to come now. And just to fill us with your spirit, to fill us with your presence, Lord, and help us to think about you, Lord. Think about what you've done, Lord. To think about who you are, to think about Christ, who is risen forever, Lord. And you have raised us with you. And we want to experience you this morning. We want to know you, Lord. We want to experience that risen Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
Strength is rising in this place this morning. As we come and worship him this morning, we praise him, we give him thanks. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. No matter what you're feeling this morning, let's turn our eyes to our Savior.
Strength for us as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength for us as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong
of it all. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Yes, you are, Jesus.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. Yes, you do. You deserve the glory. Only one. You deserve the glory. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Good morning, Three Rivers. As we come now to break bread together, I want to invite any of you who love the Lord Jesus to join us and maybe get some bread and some wine or juice. I want to start by reading the account of the Last Supper that we find in Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, starting at verse 7. Now the festival of unleavened bread had arrived, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John ahead and said, "Go and prepare the Passover meal so that we can eat it together." "Where do you want us to prepare it?" they asked him. He replied, "As soon as you enter Jerusalem, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you there. Follow him. At the house he enters, say to the owner, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will take you upstairs to a large room that is already set up. That is where you should prepare our meal." They went off to the city and found everything just as Jesus had said. And they prepared the Passover meal there. When the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus said, "I've been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. Then he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come." He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you." Now Jesus knew that he had suffering ahead, and yet he was really looking forward to sharing this traditional Passover meal with his close friends, his disciples. He thought carefully about it and he made all the necessary arrangements. This meal was really rich in symbolism, and it pointed back to God's faithfulness to the Jewish people as they left captivity in Egypt. What Jesus shared with his disciples as he broke the bread and drank wine has become what we now call communion or breaking of bread. It's a time set aside to remember and to give thanks for the cross, for the willingness of Jesus to suffer a painful death for us and to rise again in order to bring us back to a relationship with God, our Father. Notice the words in verse 19. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, Jesus doesn't say, do this in remembrance of what I'm about to do for you. Although the fact was that he was about to do the most amazing act of sacrifice ever. He wants us to remember him, Jesus, what he was like when he lived among us, what he's like today. Jesus, our brother, our Lord, our friend. Now, in the Gospels, we do see instances where Jesus heals and the recipient turns out to be more interested in what Jesus has done for them rather than in following Jesus. We see it with the lepers. Now, 10 of them were told to go to the priest, and as they all went, they were healed. 9 of them went off to the priest and to a healthy lifestyle, we presume. Only one of them returned. He returned to Jesus to thank him. He returned to Jesus to worship him. One of them wanted Jesus, not just a healing. He wanted Jesus. He wanted to follow him. So I want to take a moment now in silence to remember Jesus. As we grow in our relationship, we grow in how we can enjoy his presence with us, his love, his company. Ask him to bring to mind now anything that you might need to confess to him during this time of quiet, to ask his forgiveness for, and just enjoy his presence with us today. So let's just take a moment. Father God, we pray that you would speak to us in the silence now. Thank you for your presence. Father God, we just thank you so much for being able to come and remember this morning, to remember what Jesus did for us by his sacrifice on the cross, his body, his blood shed for us, and to remember Jesus himself, to think about him. We thank you for your presence. We thank you that we are able to have a real relationship with you every day of the week. Because of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, that you have cleansed us from all of our sin. We thank you that that is being made possible through the cross. Father God, we pray that you would lead each one of us deeper and deeper into you as we take this time to give thanks. Amen. So just as Jesus did with his disciples, we break bread, which is a symbol of his body. So let's take it and eat it together as we give thanks to him. And as we take the wine or the juice, which symbolizes his blood, which was shed for us. Let's drink together. Father God, we thank you for meeting with us this morning. We thank you for cleansing us. We thank you for speaking to us, for your presence with us. Amen.
Your majesty, I can bear back. I lay my all before you now. In royal robes I don't deserve, I live to serve your majesty. Your majesty to serve your majesty.
So, Samuel, Sarfas, what did you want to say? What's your special moment?
Special moment is being married to my fantastic wife for 21 years. And that she's brought me to the Lord and put up with me for 21 years. And my other special moment is I'm so proud of my daughter, Katrina, who turns 18 today, Sunday. And I'm so proud of her, what she's been through, and that she's a fantastic mother to my grandson, Noah.
Good morning, Three Rivers, and anybody else who is deigning us and privileging us with your presence. You're very welcome this morning, both at the family home in Denmark Street and in your own homes, as we continue to live in unique times and unusual times. But this morning, I want to continue on the vision and the theme of our vision verse, which is found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 4, and verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, says Jesus, for he has anointed me to preach or proclaim or to bring good news to the poor. And this vision verse has a relevance for every believer in the Lord Jesus and every follower of the Lord Jesus from the day that he spoke it to the day he comes back again. And every single person can apply this verse as I portrayed the last time and applied it from Acts 10 and verse 38, that Jesus was anointed of the Spirit and went about doing good. And linking that to John 14, how we as individual believers can become part of his ministry, and that we as followers of him can replicate the stuff that he did, because we have been anointed by the Spirit, the same Spirit that was in him and on him as he was prepared for his ministry through the experience of testing and temptation in the wilderness and in the desert when the enemy had a go at him. By the way, I hope you realize that the enemy has a go at you as well as a believer, and is out for you. And the more you do for Jesus, the more attack you're inviting from him. And I want to say, the only way we can combat the enemy and drive him off our lives and out of our lives is by applying this verse to you and knowing that he has applied it to you. And Jesus wasn't promoting himself when he said these words. He was promoting the Father and the Son and the Spirit. He says this: when the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, it's not his own spirit, his human spirit, or even It's not that which made Jesus who he was that was upon him. It was the Spirit of the Father and the Son and the Spirit himself. It's the Godhead that he was representing. It was the Godhead collectively and corporately that was anointing him and empowering him, because that word anointed means empowered, enabled. It's something we cannot do, even of the giftings that we have, both natural and supernatural by the Spirit. It's nothing we can employ. It's something that he deploys to us and through us. And I want you to take a moment now, believer, as you hear this sermon this morning, that you might discern the Lord's presence in it. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. No matter what your name is, and you're a believer and a follower of Jesus, you are indwelt by the Spirit of God. But as well as being indwelt, and you can be filled with the Spirit, as we talked the last time, Jesus was both anointed and filled with the Spirit. So the Spirit came upon him, but the Spirit was in him. It says he returned from the desert full of the Spirit. And we want to be full and filled with the Spirit. We can only fulfill the task that God and the role that God has given every believer individually to do by the equipping of the Spirit. He's equipped us. He's anointed us. And Jesus is called the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Christ, the Christed One, because Christ means anointed. And we can be anointed by that same Spirit. And we need to be to fulfill the calling that we have been given in him. He's called us to be his disciples, his followers. He's called us, and he called us and chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. That is amazing. That gives you such security, believer, that you have been called before the foundation of the world. But I want to say that Jesus was also called before the foundation of the world. That Jesus was called to be Messiah, to be the Anointed One, to be the Savior of the world. And when that word is used, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. In 2 Corinthians 1, it says, the Lord who is the Spirit. So the Lord is the Spirit, Father and Son together, and the Lord who is the Spirit. It's a corporate thing of the Godhead. And the Godhead take responsibility and ownership of the mission, but also of you and I. And they take responsibility for us. We're not on our own. We're equipped. We've been given all the weaponry that we need to be given. And the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And I want to just go back to Isaiah 61. As Isaiah said it, the Spirit of the Lord God. And that's why I can say it's for me and you, as well as for Jesus only. Because Isaiah used it of himself. And he was an Old Testament prophet under an old covenant, an old promise, an old agreement, better than no agreement, but not as good as the one that we live under. We live under a new covenant, a covenant of grace, a covenant of promise, a covenant of expectation, a covenant where potential can be fulfilled. The Spirit of, says Isaiah, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. There's no doubt about whose Spirit it is. He's implying and owning here. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because. For the Lord has anointed me. The Lord has anointed me. It's not his own anointing. It's not his abilities. It's not even his calling as a prophet or his office as a prophet. It's the Spirit of the Lord God. It's that Yahweh God, that Jehovah God, the God of heaven and earth, the creator God, the sustainer God, the maintainer God, the salvation God, the redeeming God. It's that God. It's the transforming God. It's the King of kings and Lord of lords. It's the sovereign God who is upon us and upon Isaiah. And if he's upon Isaiah, so much more because of what Jesus did in his life and ministry and death and resurrection, ascension and glorification. That same God has anointed you and I, believer. In all our brokenness, in all our unworthiness, He's anointed you and I. And that anointing makes us useful. That anointing confirms a value on us. It also brings us a confidence and a freedom. And I believe it releases an authority. Now, when I pray for people, I believe God is working. In fact, I expect him to work. I believe that he has no, because of what he's promised in his word, in the scriptures, he's no other choice but to work. When we honor Jesus and Jesus is glorified, the Holy Spirit comes. That's what scripture teaches, and that's what I minister out of. So come, Holy Spirit, this morning, and would you please move in the lives of every person who hears or sees me this morning. And in the life of Three Rivers Church, would you come and move this morning? And every believer would be affected by the move of the Spirit this morning. And I'm conscious of the Spirit's presence right now. I'm conscious of the Spirit's presence right now. And I'm imploring that Spirit to anoint me and give me the unction that will make a difference through my words in how you live for Jesus, in how you relate to Jesus, and how Jesus relates to you. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings, good news. The gospel is good news. And I want to say to you, many people say the gospel is Jesus. I want to say that is true, but it's also an oversimplification. The gospel is much more than just a person, Jesus. It's everything that Jesus is, and in his nature, both human, all the aspects of his human nature, in all its purity, in all its perfection, and all of who he is in his divine nature is brought to the table. And that's just mind-boggling. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me to preach good tidings, good news. And then he starts to unwrap that. To preach or to proclaim or to announce or to bring. That means not only does he proclaim it and announce it and put words out there, but the Holy Spirit brings, he delivers something. There is a transaction going on here where heaven is imparting something to human beings on earth because they've been called by God through Jesus, through the unction of the Holy Spirit, to come into a relationship and to receive Christ as Savior and Lord and to follow that Savior and Lord, that rabbi who is above all other rabbis, who people copied and in many cases impersonated. But we want to impersonate Jesus Christ in the right way so that his character and characteristics and attributes are displayed in our lives so that we might reflect him accurately and might be an influence under the anointing of the Holy Spirit to change people's lives and to bring good news. And the word that is used for bringing good news is the word evangelizo. And that word is where we get the word evangelist from, the bringer of good news. But you know what the historical context for this, historical context for this is similar to when Israel were fighting the Philistines and David was back with a family in the camp and a runner would come from the front or the interface of the two armies and would bring the news of how the war was going and how the battle was going. And he was called the evangelathio. He was bringing the good news or the bad news, but he was the bringer of the news. But evangelists and preachers for Jesus Christ are the bringers of good news. We're the runners of the good news. We're the carriers of the good news. We're the carriers of hope. We're the carriers of a renewed expectation and a different expectation because there's a different goal and a different objective in mind than there was before, because Jesus becomes the goal. Jesus becomes the expectation. Jesus is our hope. And he transforms our thinking, our motivation, our attitudes in every situation. To preach good news. And in the next couple of weeks, we will be unpacking the rest of his... This is called the Nazareth or the Jesus Manifesto. This is good news. And as a friend of some of ours has written a book on this particular passage, it's called the Manifesto of Jesus or the Nazareth Manifesto. And Gareth Lloyd-Jones from Life in the Spirit has written the book, which we've got copies of, which I strongly recommend. And you can get them from me at a price, and it'll be a knockdown price. But this book will knock you down for Jesus and will knock you into shape for Jesus. For you and I to become aware of the potential that we have, because, folks, if we became aware of that potential and under the unction of the Spirit, the anointing of the Spirit, started to live a life like this, we would transform communities, families, situations where we have not yet seen breakthrough and where there is a sense of despair and hopelessness. For the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Jesus has no plan B. This book from Gareth Lloyd-Jones is called No Plan B, based on the Jesus Manifesto or the Nazareth Manifesto. Talking about manifestos, I believe there's a big election in the world this year. And manifestos and promises will be made. Promises that a cynical electorate, both in the States and anywhere else, will say, well, we'll wait and see. There'll be the same broken promises. I want to say that this announcement that Jesus made is no empty promise. This promise was fulfilled in his own lifetime by the things that he's done. And he's been fulfilling it through the Holy Spirit and through his faithful followers, filled by the Spirit and anointed by the Spirit ever since, for centuries and generations, and will continue to be fulfilled. And we believers, beloved at Three Rivers Church, Bedford, and every other believer in the world, we can become part of this story. We can get part of the action. We can get part of the excitement that we can bring good news. Bring good news. Set people free. Change their perspective on life and change their experience of life through being filled with the same Spirit that filled Jesus. No, not a different Spirit. Not even the spirits that some of you like, but the Holy Spirit. A different type of Spirit. And the next time I preach, which I believe is next week, I'll be preaching, he brings or proclaims or announces good news to the poor. As we unpack this, let's get excited by what we can do through him. He wants us to bring freedom and hope and salvation and proclaim it with authority, with boldness, with confidence, and for that word to accomplish what he's promised it will through the anointing and the enabling of the Holy Spirit. Empowered. You feel despairing at the moment. You feel powerless in this present situation. I don't. I'm confused. I don't know how it's going to work out, but I'm not powerless, and neither are you, because you have been anointed by the Spirit of God. In your salvation, you've received the Holy Spirit who lives now within you, and your spirit carriers and your hope carriers, your glory carriers, your freedom carriers, your Jesus carriers. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Would you just fill the space Lord, fill the physical space with your presence at home, in homes, and in Denmark Street. But would you also fill this space in all our heads, between our ears, with thoughts of you? And would you fill this space underneath our rib cages? Not our physical hearts, but wherever in us our human spirits dwell. Because, Lord, you've placed in us a consciousness of your presence and of your existence, but you've also certainly placed in me an awareness and a knowledge that if somebody was to kill me right now, I might be physically dead, but something in me would continue. Not just because I believe it, but because the Word teaches it, the Word of God, the Scriptures, but because I intuitively am aware of it in my spirit and in my mind. So I say, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Make me more like Jesus. Lord, make me into the weapon that I am remade to be, born again to be. Make me into that, but not only me, Lord, but brothers and sisters who I can work alongside and who can work alongside me and see your kingdom come. See your kingdom come, your rule and your reign visibly and in reality take a hold of people's lives and people's situations. To God be the glory. Amen.
Soon return to reclaim the world for his glory.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, King of Kings. Hallelujah.
Christ alone, the cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Good morning. So we have come to the part of our service where we share words of knowledge with you. These are words that people have been given by God as they've spent time with Him through the week. And they're words for others that they feel the Holy Spirit has given them, because God wants to speak healing, wholeness, restoration into people's lives. There are just three this morning. Two of which are physical issues, and one which is more of a spiritual issue. So the first two issues are somebody that has asthma, and somebody who has recurrent headaches or migraines. That's something that's actually coming up quite a lot at the moment. And then the third word is that there's a sense that there's one or more individuals who are experiencing an empty loneliness at this time. And God wants to remind all of us, really, that as Christians, we've been given a buddy. And that buddy is a helper, a comforter, and a counsellor. And he's the Holy Spirit. And Jesus' followers are never alone. So I'm going to pray for these issues now. If any of them resonate with you, then maybe you'd like to lift your hand up just to sort of respond to what God is saying to you. And everybody else that's listening, just pray along with me as I seek God. Oh, Father God, I thank you that you are interested in every area of our lives. I thank you that you're interested in the physical, that you're interested in the emotional, that you're interested in the spiritual, that, Lord God, to you there is no difference. Father, all of it is a part of who we are and who you've made us to be. So, Lord God, I just want to come to you now. I want to thank you for the authority that we have in the name of Jesus to speak that healing and wholeness over people. And in the name of Jesus, I want to speak healing and wholeness over anybody who has asthma this morning or symptoms of asthma, and I want to speak healing and wholeness over anybody with migraines, with issues with headaches, Lord God, and I pray that you would bring that healing and wholeness in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father God, for anybody who has that sense of emptiness or loneliness, Lord, I thank you for your promise that you are always with us, that you never leave us, that you never forsake us. And Father God, I just ask that you would right now, by the power of your Holy Spirit, just flood through every single person who's feeling that sense of emptiness or loneliness, Lord. Would they just have a tangible sense of your presence with them right now, a tangible sense of your Father's arms surrounding them right now. Thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. Lord, thank you for that comfort and for that help that we receive from the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, thank you that you are our counselor. And I pray that as people turn to Jesus right now, as they fix their gaze upon him, that Holy Spirit, you would come and bring that comfort, bring that help, and that you would point people towards the truth of who Jesus is, of who they are in him, and of their dwelling place in him. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'd rather be, no place I'd rather be, no place I'd rather be than here in your love, there's no place I'd rather be, no place I'd rather be, no place I'd rather be than here in your love, set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. I want more, I want more, I want more, I want more, I want more of you, I want more, I want more. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control.
Shout.
unshaken. We will live in hope and praise with tongues rejoicing. Your spirit.